Lodge's works have elements that resemble Shakespearean plays for its use of comedy, romance, and social commentary. His pastoral poetry, such as Rosalind, reflects an appreciation for the natural world, much like Shakespeare's own use of nature in his works. He used rich and elaborate language, employing metaphors, similes, and poetic devices. Lodge, like Shakespeare, incorporated elements from classical sources into their works, adapting and reimagining stories from ancient Greek and Roman literature.
If you compare Thomas Lodge, an English writer of the Elizabethan and Jacobean eras, with William Shakespeare, you will notice conspicuous features. They were contemporaries, during exactly the same period of English Renaissance literature.
The aim of this video is to point out some suspicious inconsistencies regarding the personality and contemporary facts of all of Thomas Lodge's writings in a somewhat more systematical way. The extent of rather strange coincidences eventually should lead to question the identity of Thomas Lodge.
Let's look in the following section at essential works of Thomas Lodge a little closer.
Lodge's work Alarum Against Usurers is divided in three parts. First, the thematic pamphlet exposing the ways in which money lenders lured young heirs into extravagancy and depth. Second, annexed is the delectable history of Forbonius and Proseria. Third, annexed the lamentable complaint of Truth over England.
According to the book and studies of Nathaniel Paradise, Lodge was familiar with the original Arcadia, and he must have intended to flatter Sidney, to whom he so confidently dedicated his first major publication, Alarum Against Usurers.
Question number 1. Is it purely coincidental that Lodge dedicated this work to Philip Sidney? Even though no encounter or contextual mentioning ever has been documented between Lodge and Sidney?
Thomas Lodge's father, Sir Thomas Lodge, was Lord Mayor of London. In his will, dated December 14, 1583, the principal bequests were to his three sons, Nicholas, Benedict, and Henry, and to the family of his daughter Joan Woodford. But note, no mention was made of his son Thomas. We also learn that from the marriage of Sir Thomas with Anne resulted six sons, with two boys named Thomas, the first one baptized, died very early, the second other one, not baptized. All children's otherwise had a church date entrance of baptism.
Question 2. What may be the deeper meaning of those remarkable and strange fact of two sons, named Thomas Lodge, the first premature birth, buried June 4, 1556. The second, our poet, not baptized, birth year 1558, uncertain. Couldn't those facts support the idea of a doubtful identity of Thomas Lodge? Question number 3. Doesn't that remind us of the situation of the bishop's son Toby Matthew, whose name, the assumption is, after his death due to mental illness, was afterwards borrowed by true Shakespeare? For detailed arguments, click video link.
Thomas Lodge's Sully's Metamorphosis is an Ovidian verse fable, which is documented to have strongly influenced Shakespeare's Venus and Adonis. How did this certainty come to be? In his book, The Complete Works of Thomas Lodge, in 1883, Edmund Gosse, an English poet, author and critic, disclosed the discovery in Lodge's Metamorphosis, a poem of Glaucus and Scylla, of a stunning connection and obscure relation with William Shakespeare. We read on page 14.
It is not too much to say that Venus and Adonis is a direct imitation of Glaucus and Scylla. An imitation, indeed, which vastly outshines its original, but nonetheless was distinctly composed in emulation of the older poem.
We shall be struck by the resemblance in many points. There can be no doubt that the young Shakespeare borrowed from Lodge. None predecessor of Shakespeare has so direct an influence upon his, Shakespeare's early style, as Lodge.
Can anyone really believe such a cock and bull story? That, within a few years, true Shakespeare felt the need to imitate a yet nameless Thomas Lodge?
Don't we need a more logical and plausible explanation for those actual observations? For instance, not only the name Shakespeare, but also the name Lodge were alias or pseudonyms. Lodge and Shakespeare, the early and later masking of a singular poet genius, Marlowe. Thomas Lodge dedicated Scylla's Metamorphosis to Master Ralph Crane. Be aware, his close connection with some of the first folio texts has led Trevor Howard Hill, a scholar of English literature and leading figure in English book history, to call Ralph Crane Shakespeare's first editor.
Question number 6. Do you have any idea who Ralph Crane really was, or might have been?
All we know of Crane, we must extract from his single work, The Works of Mercy, or from the second edition, with a new title, 4 years later, The Pilgrim's New Year's Gift. For more details, click video link above.
Question number 7. Can anybody really argue against the arguments of the video that Ralph Crane is not identical with the true Shakespeare and must have belonged to the multiplicity of his pen names?
Thomas Lodge's prose romance, Rosalind, was published in 1590. It is, believe it or not, widely taken for granted today as the main source of Shakespeare's play As You Like It. Walter Wilson Gregg, a leading bibliographer and Shakespeare scholar of the 20th century, concluded in his book that we have in Lodge's Rosalind practically the perfect outline and groundwork of Shakespeare's play As You Like It. The story in itself, as we know it, apart from its dramatic presentation, is the work of Thomas Lodge.
Both works, Rosalind and As You Like It, share stunning similarities and characters. The protagonist, Ganymede, or Rosalind. In Rosalind, the main character who disguises herself as a boy is named Rosader. In As You Like It, Rosalind tails on the male disguise of Ganymede, the exiled duke. Rosalind features Gerismond, the exiled Duke. As You Like It has Duke Senio in a similar role. In the forest settings. Both works have a significance portion. Taking place in the forest of Arden. Rosalind falls in love with Aelina. In As You Like It, Rosalind, disguised as Ganymede. And Celia, disguised as Aelina. And more.
Question number 8. Is it really logical or plausible to think that true Shakespeare, with his play As You Like It, was dependent on the ideas of his contemporary, Thomas Lodge? Question number 9. Isn't it far more logical, realistic, and possible that the singular and only true poet genius, alias pseudonymous Lodge, felt the need to improve his early dramatic yet unripe project, Rosalind, to re-edit it later as You Like It, under his frequently altered pen names, now Shakespeare?
Euphues Shadow, note, allegedly written by Thomas Lodge, was published in 1592. It contains two dedications by Robert Greene to the nobility, with stunning and very evident imitations and striking similarities to Lyly's prose works.
For those not familiar with the term euphues, it refers to a particular style of highly elaborate prose in Elizabethan literature. It resulted from two prose romances, The Anatomy of Wit, 1578, and its sequel, Euphues and His England, 1580, both written by John Lyly.
Question number 10. How to explain the stunning and evident imitations and striking similarities of Lodge's work to Lyly's prose works?
The title emblem of Lodge's, Euphues Shadow, in 1591, corresponds to the anonymous second report on Dr. Faustus, highly likely by Marlowe. Now containing, within the emblem, a man, Faustus, and the death, Mephistopheles. Thus, with a modified emblem of hope, compared to the emblems on Shakespeare's Opus 1, Venus and Adonis, and Opus 2, Lucrece.
Question number 11. How to explain the stunning and evidently modified emblem, the anchor of hope, on Lodge's work as well as on Marlowe's work, which otherwise characterized Shakespeare's first work, Opus 1, Venus and Adonis, and Opus 2, Lucrece?
The collection of prose tales, entitled The Life and Death of William Longbeard, A, was Lodge's first work, 1593, after Marlowe's final disappearance. The year 1593 also saw the publications of Lodge's sonnet cycle, Phyllis, B, and the anonymous poetic miscellany, The Phoenix Nest, C, contained 14 works with 79 poems and 3 prose pieces.
Let's dare to deduce the virtually unimaginable but plausible assumption that The Life and Death of William Longbeard can best be interpreted as Marlowe's masked allegoric early literary disclosure or simile after his alleged fatal downfall in 1593.
In this allegoric tale, about life and death of William Longbeard, Lodge tells us surprising autobiographical details of William's life, allegorically unrecognizable through his long beard. Such as,
William with the long beard was born in London, of greater mind than of high parentage, a graft of mighty hope at the first, though, as it afterwards proved, his parents spent too much hope on so little virtue. This free citizen born in London was trained up in good letters, wherein he profited so suddenly that most men wondered at his capacity, and the wisest were afraid of the conclusion. And for that the age wherein he was bred, being the third year of Henry II, was full of troubles, this young man's rare gifts were raked up in the embers, little regarded. Because not yet ripened, but at last, as years increased, the mind ordained, for mighty things began to mount the rather, because ambition sealed his eyes, which made him with the dove soar so high.
This goes on and on, with numerous similar allusions. Thus begun the first fruits of his impiety. The sequel, whereof exceedeth all conceit, and testifieth his damnable nature. A man beloved of all men for his upright dealing, and lamented of all men, for his untimely death, he suborned certain sinister confederates of his. For which cause poor man being suddenly apprehended, to accuse him of treason.
Thomas Lodge's epitaph on William Longbeard, written at the end, in the first person, must definitely be seen as a blueprint of Marlowe's fate. Just listen.
Untimely death, and my found fruits of treason, my lawless lust, my murthers long concealed, how shipwrecked life, amidst my April season, thus covered things at last, will be revealed. A shameful death, my sinful life succeedeth, and fear of heavenly judge, great terror breeds. My mangled members, in this grave included, have answered law's extremes, to my confusion, O God, let not my murthers be obtruded against my soul, wrong through my earth's illusion. And as the grave my liveless limbs contains, so take my soul to thee where rest remains. Thou travailer, that treadest on my tomb, remembereth thee of my untimely fall, prevent the time for thinky, what may become, see that thou will be to thy reason thrall, scorn world's delights, esteem then honor small, so mayst you die with fame, where men of conscience foul perish with shame and hazard of their soul.
Question number 12. Must not those personal confessions, within this epitaph printed in the year 1593, of Marlowe's enforced disappearance, definitely be understood as Marlowe's autobiographic, allegorical, revelation of his fatal destiny?
Question number 13. Who else could Thomas Lodge want to have immortalized with this highly evocative, suggestive epitaph?
Be fully aware, there are many more allusions on Marlowe in Lodge's long beard. Let's just reflect some stunning lines in one of three directly following hymns to the same person.
The pity, Lord, that first inflamed my heart to entertain a voluntary death. Vouchsafe those snare it may unloose, wherein this blinded world has me entrapped.
Question number 14. Wasn't Marlowe's voluntary death the perfect fabricated, faked conspiracy?
Reflect a last, stunning observation. The title emblem on Lodge's long beard tale. corresponds to the emblem on Marlowe's translation of Lucan's first book.
Question number 15. Can this title emblem match be purely accidental? What is the deeper meaning of this emblem?
Note. George Wither. The absolute most compelling pen name of true Shakespeare at all. In his collections of emblems, gave us an interpretation.
The letter Tau, in ancient times, was used as a symbol for life or resurrection, whereas Theta was considered a symbol of death.
Consider George Wither, a definite pseudonym of true Shakespeare, marked himself on his engraving with the evocative final English lines. Yet few, by good men, have been more approved. None so unseen, so generally loved. For more details on Wither, click link above.
The Roman drama, The Wounds of Civil War, created around 1586, depicts the harrowing confrontation between Gaius Marius and Sulla. The play, perhaps the earliest true chronicle play, precursor of the masterpieces of Shakespeare, was published in 1594 and remained unprinted for two centuries. A majority of scholars agree that this play is a feeble imitation of Marlowe's Tamburlaine.
Charles Walters Whitworth, in his dissertation on Thomas Lodge, described stunning text parallels between Marlowe and Lodge. Two examples. Just read and compare it.
Question number 16. Should any expert really tell you that these text parallels between Lodge and Marlowe, both printed in 1594, came from brains of two different poets? Question number 16. Again, should any expert really tell you that these stunning contextual parallels arose from brains of different poets?
Lodge's sonnet cycles, Phyllis, together with the narrative poem, The Complaint of Alciard, was printed in 1593, the year of Marlowe's final disappearance.
It starts with an absolute revealing induction of 8 poems. Just contemplate, only the very, very first of those poems.
One, I, that obscured, meaning, I have to live concealed. Two, have fled the scene of fame, meaning, I am enforced to leave the theater. Three, entitling my conceit to naught, but care, meaning, I am entitled to nothing but sorrow. Four, I live a phoenix life, meaning, rising from the ashes. Five, felt that death, I never would declare, meaning, I never would disclose my demise. Six, now mount the theater of my age, meaning, visit now my theater plays. 7. To plead my faith, meaning, I will defend my convictions.
Question number 17. How to explain that Thomas Lodge in his sonnet cycle, Phyllis, in the year 1593, of Marlowe's disappearance, started with a stunning blueprint of crucial essentials of his, Marlowe's actual life situation.
All other of the 8 induction poems of Phyllis could be analyzed in the same or similar way. Let's do without it, but instead listen to Professor Cinta Zanino Garrido.
Professor Cinta Zanino Garrido, senior lecturer at the University of Jean, in her chapter 9, encourages the opinion that Lodge, in Phyllis, overcomes the limitations of a poetical composition by the essential idea of a muse, that is the imaginative competence, used in so many sonnet cycles by ostensibly so different poets. As concealed true Shakespeare, or Lodge,
not only between Lodge and Marlowe, there existed an obscure literary relation, but also between Lodge and an even more obscure sonneteer, William Smith, from whom we know virtually nothing. No birth or living date, no death date, except his high-level sonnet cycle Chloris, 1596, marking him, on the title, as a despised poet.
Question number 18. How would you explain the stunning textual concordances, like those here in Sonnet 9 of both Lodge and Smith? Shakespeare Academe always offers us two poor unsatisfactory answers. Either it is coincidental or it was plagiarism. Whoever stole from whom? Question number 19. Isn't the logic of a compelling identity of both Lodge and Smith in the sense of a multiple pseudonymity of a single poet genius more rational? Question number 20. Do not sonnet 17 and 25 of Chloris clearly reveal Marlowe with his verse epos Hero and Leander and his play Dido?
In Lodge's moralizing pamphlet, Wit's Misery, A Portrait of Usury, printed in 1596, we find one of his most mature works. England's Parnassus includes 11 quotations from Wit's Misery. None of them, however, are attributed to Lodge. The compiler Robert Allott seems not to have known who wrote it.
Question number 21. Couldn't this strange observations of quotations from Lodge's Wit's Misery in England's Parnassus have something to do with Lodge's obscure identity?
Charles Whitworth, in his dissertation on Lodge, came to an essential conclusion related to Wit's Misery by stating that the satirical work Wit's Misery exhibits this peculiar characteristic of Lodge's, this conjunction of contraries.
Question number 22. Doesn't this labeling of Lodge, his peculiar characteristic of contraries, fit exactly with Marlowe's literary brand core?
Charles Whitworth in his dissertation on Lodge, page 34, stated, Marlowe's Dr. Faustus is the play with which Lodge's A Looking Glass has most in common.
And also Robert Adger Law confirmed this in his article, A Looking Glass and the Scripture in 1939, when writing,
the fullest and most satisfactory discussion of the relation between Dr. Faustus Marlowe and the Looking Glass, Lodge, is that in the recent volume, Thomas Lodge, The History of an Elizabethan, by N.B. Paradise, declaring that the similarities between these two plays are so close that they indicate a direct relation between them. Paradise first cited five close verbal parallels, the first of which is from Dr. Faustus Marlowe and Burnt the Topless Towers of Ilium. The second from A Looking Lassa, Lodge. 600th Towers that topless touch the clouds.
Lodge wrote the drama, A Looking Glass, around 1590, which was printed in 1594. This work is even more forceful in its moral appeal. The setting is Nineveh, which, modeled on Christopher Marlowe's Tamburlaine the Great, is ruled by a tyrant.
Question 23. Is it coincidental that the similarities between Marlowe's play Dr. Faustus and Lodge's play, A Looking Glass, are so close?
In Charles Whitworth's dissertation on Lodge we read, Lodge wrote blank verse that sounded like that of plays written at about the same time. And none of them was a genius like Marlowe, who could single-handedly revolutionize dramatic poetry. Paradise's concepts denies such genius to any. But a Marlowe or a Shakespeare. If Lodge had had Tamburlaine to imitate, his blank verse would sound more like Marlowe's. The proof is that blank verse written after Tamburlaine, Lodge's included, does sound more like Marlowe's.
Question number 24. How to explain, according to N. Paradise? A. That Thomas Lodge's blank verse sound more like Marlowe's. And B. That the concept of blank verse denies such genius to any but Marlowe. Equals true Shakespeare.
Lodge's Satires and Epistles, A Figure for Momus, appeared in 1595, different in mood, as well as in style and form, from anything before. In the Epistle to the Gentleman Readers, Lodge speaks of writing in that form wherein no man might challenge me with servile imitation form. Since Lodge is addressing also an own epistle to Drayton in A Figure for Momus, this is of some significance.
Lodge expert Charles Whitworth enlightens us when writing that the names in Lodge's A Figure for Momus constitute the nearest thing we have to an autobiographical document from this period of Lodge's life.
Lodge, in his Epistle 5, in a strange juxtaposition or association of Drayton with himself, describes allegorically Drayton's spirit as ill-employed, while both of their poems, our poetry, were vain consequences of wine. Not but the misemployment of both, our gifts, ordained for arts, but spent in shameless shifts.
Question number 25. Isn't Lodge's Epistle 5 to Drayton in 1595? See small excerpt here. A definite clue to Drayton as a covert double of the real author, similar to Lodge. For extensive details of Drayton's pseudonymity, click link above.
There are many more, up to now, unanswered question related to Thomas Lodge. Let's leave it with just those 30.
Question number 26. Why there is such a large temporal gap between Lodge's end of literary career, 1603, and his death, 1625? Question number 27. Why Lodge stopped his literary career 20 years before his death? Question number 28. Why there does not exist a single picture, engraving, or portrait of Thomas Lodge at his lifetime? Question number 29. Until 1920, little in the way of serious research was done on Lodge's life or works. Why he was appreciated mainly as Shakespeare's predecessor and foil. Conclusive question number 30. To what extent did the 30 unanswered questions convince you that there must be something wrong with the true identity of Thomas Lodge?